And I'll go ahead with the roll call. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to everyone. Welcome to the At-Large Capacity Building Program 2016, our 12th webinar on the topic Public Technical Identifiers, PTI, taking place on Wednesday, 21st of December 2016 at 2000 UTC. We'll not be doing a roll call as it's a webinar, but if I could please remind all participants on the phone bridge, as well as computers, to mute your speakers and microphones when not speaking. Please don't forget to state your name before speaking, not only for the transcript purposes, but to allow our interpreters to identify you on the other language channels. We have English, Spanish, and French interpretation. Thank you all for joining. I am now turning over to Tijani Benjema, the chair of At Large Capacity Building Working Group. Thank you very much, and over to you, Tijani.
Thank you, Eshin. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. This is the 12th webinar of our capacity building program for 2016. This webinar will be about the public technical identifiers, or if you want, the post-transition IANA. We have two distinguished speakers, Lise, Fuhr, who used to be one of the co-chairs of the CWG transition, and Mohamed and Bashir, who used to be one of the vice chairs of the ICG. Those two speakers will today explain to you what is the PTI. And before we go forward, I will ask the staff, machine particularly, to make some housekeeping announcement. So, machine, please go ahead.
Thanks so much, Tijani. Yishim speaking. Let's take a quick look at the housekeeping presentation. Okay, so we'll have a question and answer poll during this webinar. As you see, it's located on the left bottom side of the AC room. So if you have any questions, we do encourage you to type them in here, and they will be directed to our presenters. We also have a pop quiz section, and as you see, it will be located on the middle right side of the AC. After the speaker's presentation, please be ready to answer the questions posted in the poll post. And finally, we'll have a user experience part. There will be a 7-question survey at the end of the webinar, so please stay around for 3 minutes or so to get them completed. Thanks so much, and back over to you, Tijani.
Thank you very much, Shishim. So now that those housekeeping are done, I will ask Mohamed and Lise to make their presentation about PTI. So Mohamed and Lise, please go ahead. Who will go first? I think Mohamed, perhaps. Mohamed?
Thank you very much, Tijani. And good morning, good evening, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much, Tijani. In my presentation, I will present to you the IANA functions and the history of the IANA functions until the establishment of the PTI. I hope you can hear me very well.
Yes, Mohamed, we can hear you well. This is Ishim.
Thank you very much. A brief bit of history. Before the establishment of ICANN, what we call the IANA critical functions for the Internet were done by John Postel. And John Postel, he's one of the great fathers of the Internet. John Postel was working at the Information Science Institute at the University of Southern California, which that center had a contract with the Department of Defense. And at that time, John Pastel was managing the IANA functions. There is some people, elderly people now, or fathers of the internet now, they remember the days when they get IP addresses written in a note paper given by John Pastel at that time. This function of this critical IANA function then has been managed by ICANN under a contract between ICANN and the U.S. Department of Commerce. So what is IANA? And what is basically IANA functions? So IANA is the Internet Assigned Numbers Authority. And when we say numbers, it's not just numbers. IANA is responsible for critical technical identifiers which enable the Internet to function. Those are the domain names, system, the IP addresses, the number and resources, and the protocol parameters. Those unique identifiers are very critical for the operation of the Internet. We need IP addresses to identify servers and requesters of information in the Internet. We need domain names so we are, as humans, we can access websites and information in an easy way. And we need web services to operate using protocols on the Internet. So those critical elements for the running of the Internet are coordinated globally through the IANA function. IANA has been founded in 1988, although the term itself, IANA, have been known since 1972. The first time the reference of the term IANA has been in an RFC 1060, which was published in 1990. And in that RFP, basically, it mentions IANA functions and lists all the previous RFCs. An RFC is the request for comments document, which is almost a technical protocol document. So usually we refer to those resources, the names, the domain names, the numbers, and the protocols. So basically, who are the customers of the IANA function? The customers of the IANA functions are the organizations which are responsible for managing those resources. So for example, for domain names, top-level domain registries, request changes and through the IANA. And when those changes are implemented in the Internet route, we see it as users. For example, if there's a new top-level domain introduced in the Internet, it has to be added to the route, and it has to be referenced in a database or repository so all of DNS servers could know about it. And that's the function, and that's where IANA comes. The same applies to distributing and managing IP addresses allocation to regional internet registries. We distribute that to businesses, internet service providers, and users in the world. And the protocol parameters community, which is represented by the Internet Engineering Task Force, which issues RFCs and protocol parameters for the internet services, are using the IANA services to have a one global repository of those protocol parameters records. So the IANA function is very critical for the operation of the internet. There is lots of misunderstanding and misinformation about what IANA really does and what are the IANA functions. The IANA functions are very narrow technical functions. So IANA does not develop policies. The policies for the domain names and IP allocations and protocol parameters are done and developed in the community, which is basically ICANN and regional internet registries and the Internet Engineering Task Force. So IANA does not develop any policies. IANA as well does not select or decide on country codes, the two-letter country codes, .UK, .US, because basically IANA uses the ISO list 31661, which is provided by the International Standards Organizations as a reference. And also, there was lots of political misunderstandings to the role of IANA in terms of the management of the country codes. IANA does not decide who manages the country domain names registry, and that decision is made by the local internet community. IANA does due diligence to ensure that when there is a change request from a country, from a registry in a country, there's a clear procedure and there's checks and balance to ensure that this request is legitimate and correct. And here we come to explain the role of the U.S. government and IANA. So basically, ICANN is used to perform the IANA function based on a contract between ICANN and the U.S. Department of Commerce. So if ICANN received a request for changes, it's due to due diligence and the technical checks required, and then it passed this request to DRC for file checks before implementation. And that oversight role has created lots of misunderstandings about the nature of this role and has created tensions, geopolitical tensions about the role of the U.S. government in this critical function. So here you can see that IANA is within ICANN. It used to be within ICANN, and it had a contract with the U.S. Department of Commerce, represented by the NTIA, the National Telecommunications and Information Administration, and that's an oversight contract for historical reasons, because that's where the internet actually initially was managed in the U.S. In March 2014, the U.S. government has announced its intention to give away its stewardship role or the oversight role over the IANA function, which is managed by ICANN, to the global internet community. And that has been welcomed by everyone in the internet community, because now we can say that the global internet community manage the IANA function without intervention from any single government. So the U.S. government has asked ICANN, because ICANN has been managing IANA function since 1998 to convene this transition process. That's, by the way, this transition is expected for a long time, and it basically was part of the early envisaged privatization plan for the BNS, which is outlined by the U.S. government in 1997. So it was not a surprise, but it took time really for ICANN to mature and for the community to start this process. There were four guiding principles requested by NTIA in terms of the transition. The transition needs to support and enhance the multi-stakeholder model and to maintain security and stability of the DNS. And also, it needs to maintain the expectation of the AI services customers and sustain the openness of the internet. NTIA was clear in its announcement that would not accept a proposal that replaced the current manager of IANA with a government-led organization or intergovernmental organization. So that was outside the picture. So the whole community, the domainness community, the members community, and the protocol parameters community started a lengthy process of transition from the U.S. government stewardship oversight role to the global internet community. The IANA coordination group was formed representing about 13 different communities from the global internet community. And each customer's community, the members, the domain names, and the protocols had developed their own proposals, which was combined at the end by the ICG. That proposal has been submitted to the NTIA, and if you are following up this process closely, there were heated discussions in the U.S. Congress about the transition of this critical role from the U.S. government to the global internet community, and the U.S. Congress has held two hearings regarding this important transitions. During that process, the community has been working on enhancing the accountability of ICANN to ensure that after the transition from the U.S. government oversight role, ICANN will continue its role as a global organization, transparent and accountable to the community. So those bias changes required to ensure the transparency and accountability of ICANN has been implemented. And basically, the NTIA ICANN contract has expired on 30th of October, last 30th of October. PTI has been established in August in preparation for the expiry of the contract and started operating the IANA functions since October. So the public technical identifiers as a body is now managing the IANA function, and it's separated from ICANN. It has its own board, and it has its own customer standing committee, which is basically the group of customers or communities benefiting from the IANA functions who are over the IANA, the performance of the PTI. The website of the PTI is pti.icann.org currently, and we're working to establish an dedicated website. So I leave from here to Lise, where she will give you more details about PTI and its structure. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mohamed. Thank you. Good evening, or hello, everyone. I'm Lise Fuhr. I'm one of the two co-chairs of the CWG IANA Stewardship. The other co-chair was Jonathan Robinson, and as Mohamed is saying, it's been a lengthy process, but I also think it's been a really good one. I've all through the 2 years worked very close with Jonathan as the other co-chair and the group as such. For me, actually, the whole process is a very good proof of the multi-stakeholder model as such. So I must say it's been hard, but very educational for all. I'm not going to talk a whole lot about the process, but I'm only going to mention that after the proposal was submitted and signed off by the different communities, we actually began the implementation, and the CWG stewardship, which was only created to make a proposal for the transition, actually continued as an implementation team. So everything that was being implemented was done in the spirit of the proposal, and everything was ready for the 1st of October. As you can see, I've chosen to use a picture of Madrid. That's partly because I work in Brussels, but also because I think it's a very good picture of a bit of the surrealism that we have experienced with some of the American protests against all this, but also that what you see is that, like, if we look at the next picture, sorry, for is that a picture of a pipe or is it a painting? So, and it all depends on the eyes that look, and it's the same with the multi-stakeholder model and with the whole proposal. Is it something that actually going to include the whole internet world? I do believe it is, but some would say it's only for the very few. But that's not going to be the discussion of today. I've made a short agenda on this. I'm going to take you quickly through the composition of PTI and CSC, because I think those are the most important things. And then I will go through the background for the PTI board, tell you a bit of the board composition and the way forward. I'm not going to go into extreme details because we have talked a lot about this. We have been through a lot of this, and if you have any questions, feel free to ask them, and I'll do my best to answer them. I also see I have fellow members from the CWG stewardship on the call who I also rely on can help me if there are any problems with this. But if we look at before and now, it actually says the current contract. It's not the current anymore. It's the old one. But I'm using an old picture. So and I know it's a little small, but I hope you can enlarge it to see. But on the left, you can see that actually before 1st of October, NTIA was the oversight. They had the contract with ICANN, and they had the oversight. And having the oversight of IANA actually means that every change in contact person, every change in the name server, every small or little change had to be authorized by NTIA or the US government. Not that they misused this power at all. I think they did a great job, but that was something that was going to change with the transition. And historical, this was never going to be the case for as long as it was. It was actually in 98, 99, it was foreseen that this should be, the transition should have happened much earlier. But the new model is actually a legal separation of the IANA function into what we called the post-transition IANA. That was short for PTI, and that's also been used for the new name of the organization. But that's actually the IANA function being separated into a small affiliate of ICANN with it. It has its own board. It has, and this board is consisting of 5 members. I'm going to explain you a little more about this. You also have the Customer Standing Committee, and the Customer Standing Committee is also something that we are going to discuss at a later slide, but this is actually the body that oversees the day-to-day operation of the PTI. They do it on a monthly basis, but they're overseeing PTI are actually complying with the service level agreements that are between the different customers. Above the CSC, you see the IANA function for view, the IFR, and that's a group that's not a standing committee. It's actually a group that will be created when we have the reviews. The reviews is planned to take, the first one is to take place 3 years after the creation of PTI, so that's 3 years from 1st of October 16. And after that, it's every 5 years, because when we created the proposal, we didn't want to have too many reviews for, because you need to give IANA also some peace to operate, and we hope that CSC will manage to untangle any problems that arise along the way of minor character. So the reviews are more to take sanity check of the structure, is it working as expected, and what how are the satisfaction with the services. This doesn't mean that if a situation arises that cannot be solved easily by the CSC or any other or the board, you can have a special review, but we don't foresee or hope that that will ever happen. If we go down to the combined proposal, just very quickly, because as you see, there is an agreement between ICANN and PTI, and there is a relationship between a strong relationship between the naming functions and PTI. This is partly because the GTLDs are within the ICANN setup, whereas the protocol and the numbering have a different structure, and while they are related to ICANN, they have a different dependency on ICANN. So both the IETF and the IRRs are having memorandum of understandings with ICANN. They have a different way of having the oversight of if their SLEs or SLAs are being or they're complying with the SLA. So it's a different model, and they're not a part of the customer standing committee. This was it was an open question from the start, but they chose to have this structure when they finalized their proposal. So it's the three communities that are served by PTI, but they have different relationships. If we look at the customer stand committee, it's actually established to perform, as you see, the operational oversight, which was performed by the U.S. Department. But there is an important change here, where the U.S. government actually authorized any change. This is not happening with the customer standing committee. They're only monitoring the performance. And they have monthly meetings on the basis of a report that's made by PTI. And actually, they work very closely at the moment together with PTI to establish the report they have to receive every month and the different procedures they will be working after. Because when the proposal was there, it was left to the CSC to establish themselves and then to actually fulfill the frame that was in the proposal, because we meant it was better to have the CSC work together with PTI in order to define and find out the procedures, the reports, how often they want to meet. We proposed once a month, and I believe that's what they do. But it was pretty open how actually to perform the function itself. As you can see on this slide, the CC composition is there are two GTLD registry operators, there's two CCTLDs operators, and there's a liaison from PTI, which is mandatory. And it's mandatory to have one from PTI because we thought it was essential to have someone from PTI to actually be at the CSC meetings, communicate, and ensure the whole dialogue and flow between CSC and PTI in order to ensure that information is there and you don't have any misunderstandings and expectations are aligned all along the way. Other liaisons were not mandatory and voluntary, and that's from the GNSO, from ALAC, from NRO or ASO, from the GAC, RSAC, and FSAC. And I believe all has said yes to be a part of this, and I also think the timing right now is very important because it's now that you built the CSC as such, with the procedures, et cetera. So right now is the moment to be in this group and ensure that you have as much transparency, as much accountability as possible. And all the meetings are open. Everyone can participate. All the reports are open. So it's actually should be very transparent, and it's open for everyone to be there if they want to listen in to what's going on. If we look at the PTI board, it's actually part of the new setup, because if you have a legal separation, you need a separate board. It's actually, it was chosen together with legal advisors that five directors would be the minimum. But we also wanted a board that would shouldn't be big or and heavy and a complex board. It should be a lightweight board that would handle PTI in a way so you don't make a lot of huge changes, but you actually fulfill the legal requirements when you have an affiliate. So five was chosen, and on top of that, the PTI was suggested to have three directors who are employed by ICANN and two additional independent directors, which for the moment are Jonathan and me. We are the independent directors, but we're not chosen by the nominated by the NOMCOM because we're interim for the next year, while a NOMCOM is actually building a procedure and requirements for the independent directors. So from next year, from late next year, there will be two independent directors which will be nominated by NOMCOM. But at the moment, the board consists of Elise Garrick as the president of PTI. We have David Conrad, who is the CTO of ICANN, Akram Atala, who is the president of Global Domains Division in ICANN, and Jonathan and me. This composition was actually, with Elise, David, and Akram, was also a composition that we proposed in the proposal because we wanted to ensure that the president of PTI was there. Akram is the one dealing with PTI matters within ICANN, and also you have David Cunran, who's being in charge of the technical issues within ICANN. So this composition was foreseen to be the best and covering most competences within ICANN, and it was actually built to cover both the PTI but also the ICANN responsibility. So if we look at the way forward, well, as I told you, the PTI board at the moment with interim directors. We have to give time to NOMCOM to set up the requirements. The PTI board has met three times, two on a call, and there's one face-to-face. We're going to meet early January or mid-January. All the meeting minutes and et cetera are also public, so we're publicizing the board material and a summary of our decisions under the same rules as the ICANN board. If we look at the CSC, they are in the startup phase. They're meeting, I can't remember if they've had four meetings, and they are planning to meet face-to-face at every ICANN meeting. So do actually the PTI board also plan to meet face-to-face at the ICANN meetings, because it's always good to have the interaction you get from meeting face-to-face instead of only having calls. And then, of course, we have the review of PTI that will come in 3 years' time. So if we look at it, it's actually that the work has just begun. We have implemented the proposal, but there is still a lot of work ahead of us. There's a lot of new structures that needs to be incorporated, that needs to be agreed upon. There is a new culture for PTI. When we did this proposal, there was some concern about being separated, and we need to see how this actually, if people feel now secure that they still have the same position, because it was not, there was no intention to actually change the internal organization of PTI in a great way. It was more to do the legal separation. So we have to see how that works out, and also how the CSC is getting along. I've been following some of their threads, and they've been very satisfied with the report so far from PTI, which for me is a very good sign, and they seem to have a very good flow. But time will show how this will continue. And I know that we were supposed to talk for a whole hour, but I think we should, this is what I have now for PTI, and I'll hand it over to Tijani to carry on. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Lise. Thank you for this presentation. Thank you, Mohamed, also for your presentation, for your introduction. Before going forward, perhaps I will ask Yashin to present the pop quiz, if she's ready. The question.
Hi, Tijani. Sure. Let's first start with our first question. The first question is, what are the three critical internet resources coordinated by IANA, which is now PTI? Please write your answers in the blank space, and don't forget to click the icon next to it so it will be posted. This time we have a different pop quiz section. We don't have the multiple choice questions. Okay, I see the answers coming through. And I will be asking Mohamed about the correct answers. But I see that he is disconnected, unfortunately, and we're trying to reach him out on the phone bridge at the moment. So maybe Lisa, you would like to answer?
Oh yes, I would. It's actually protocol numbers and names. So yes. Someone also thinks main names, number resources, and protocol parameter assignments, but that's also completely correct. Thank you.
Okay, thanks so much. Let's quickly move on to our second question then. The second question is here now. Oh, and I do see that Mohamed is connected back on the phone bridge. The second question is, why the IANA functions is critical to the internet? Again, please write your answers in the blank space. And also, please don't forget to click the icon next to it, so we will be receiving your answers. Let's wait a bit more, because we haven't received any answers yet. Okay. It's coming right now. Perfect. And Mohamed, maybe you would like to give us the correct answer for this one.
I think the three answers are partly correct. Yes, it's ensured that we have resources allocated properly and are unique, so we can have one interoperable, secure, stable internet. So it's most of the answers combined together, I think they will give a comprehensive answer, yes.
Okay, thanks so much. Let me move on to our next question, which is, what is CSC? Please type your answers. Okay, we started to receive. Perfect. And Lisa, maybe you would like to answer this question?
Yes, it's actually a customer standing committee. So it's not community, but that's close enough. So it's good. It is a customer standing committee. Thank you.
Thanks so much. And now I will move on to our last question. How big is the board? And Lisa, maybe you would like to make a clarification on the question? Like,
It's how many people are on the PTI board, but it seems that people are actually getting it, so I only see the correct answers, so that's very good. I'm impressed.
Okay. Perfect. So Tijani, this was the end of our pop quiz section. Would you like to take it over, or would you like me to go ahead with the survey?
No. Thank you very much, Jim. Now we will go to questions and answers, Q&A. It is time now for our attendees to ask questions to the two presenters. I would like to say that today Lise is on the PTI board, and Mohamed is the liaison of the ALAC on the CSC. So both of them are deeply involved in the process. So please make use of their presence and ask them as much questions as you want, so that you understand better PTI and CSC. Any question? I would ask this question, if I may. I would ask them, are the two other communities, other than the naming community, linked or working with PTI? I think this is a question that you should ask.
Do you want me to answer that, Tijani? It's Lisa.
Yes, please. Yes, please. Yes. Go ahead, please.
Okay. There is they are linked to PTI. They are in communication with PTI, but they do it from a different way. So they just monitor that their service level agreement is being complied with, whereas the other one has an actual group that is in communication every month with the CSC. The others are not in the same structured way. It's not that it's unstructured, but I don't believe they have monthly meetings with PTI on this. On another side, I'd like to also inform you there is a group between that actually consists of both the names and the numbers and the protocols that actually are looking after the legal issues in relation to the name IANA and the domain name. And this is placed in the IETF trust, but there is a group that's in place. So if there is any problem arising with the IP rights, intellectual property rights in relation to the domain name, this can actually be, this group can be activated and deal with this on behalf of both the names and the numbers and the protocols. Because the name IANA is important and the domain name IANA is also important for all the three communities. That was a little detour. Yeah, sorry for this, but okay.
Yes, I understand. I asked this question because if you look at the diagram that you presented, PTI is only for the names, for naming function. And when it was designed at the beginning, I had the hope, and I am not the only one. Several of us inside the end users had the hope that the PTI would be the old IANA. Means that the three functions will go through it. It will be operating the three functions. But I understood that neither the number community nor the protocol community wanted to do it in this way, and that's why they have their own MOU with ICANN, their own SLA also with ICANN. So apparently there is no relation with the PTI for those two functions. But as you said, and that's why we hope that the PTI should be common for all the functions, because you cannot separate the three functions. If you separate them, you may.
Yeah. Yeah,
yes.
Sorry to interrupt in this, because there's not any difference from before, because the thing is that before PTI was incorporated into ICANN, it was its own department, but the agreements were between IETF and the IRRs. This is still the case. It's just that you have instead of a department within ICANN, it's an affiliate of ICANN who actually performs this. So I don't see a huge difference from this. I think it's very much the same setup. Of course, you made the legal separation, but it has always been ICANN and not IANA who had the agreements with the other communities too. And PTI are still performing all the technical parts for the protocols and the numbers too. So for me, it's more something that you see on the overview as where it looks like it's very separated. But I see that Olivier has his hand up. He might want to chime in here too, so he might have a different opinion.
Thanks very much.
Go ahead, please.
Thanks very much, Tejani. Olivier Crépin speaking. I'm actually not going to comment on this. I was going to ask another question.
Go ahead.
Okay, thanks. So, Olivier Crépin speaking. I have a question with regards to the reporting on the service level expectations that have been designed. I was looking at the IANA website, Internet Assigned Numbers Authority, and the performance standards metrics report have been published all the way until 2006-09-30, because obviously these reports have to be regularly published for ICANN's performance on the IANA functions based on the contract that it had with the U.S. government. Now, as we know, that contract finished at the end of September, And I'm looking at where I could find the reports ever since. It seems the IANA page has not been updated. I'm looking at the Public Technical Identifiers webpage at pti.icann.org, and I don't see, I see latest update, draft PTI FY18 operating plan and budget. I mean, perhaps it would be good to have a link on the IANA website to the new location for these reports. And would you please be so kind to let me know where the reports are? Because I've read one report that was released, I think, yesterday, that was showing that everything was running well, but I just can't find it on any website.
Thank you, Olivier. Please.
Yes, thank you. I have not checked up on this, but I'll do that right away, and I'll make sure that they release all the reports, because it's been the intention all the time, and we've been told that they would make a specific website for PTI where you would have the report, but also all the board material, because it has been the principle all along that there should be full transparency and accountability on this. So I will have to, it's linked on the, I see something is actually saying it's linked under the SCSC subsite, but.
Yeah, correct. Yeah, sorry, so Olivier speaking. I've just looked. It is under the CSU website, but one, you know, there should be pointers to these things. There should be pointers to the PTI new website and pointers to the CSU website. And it should be made a little bit more welcoming for people, because at the moment it looks like the standard ICANN acronym-filled mumble jumble. Thanks.
I like that description. I will erase it. For the right people. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll get the second one also. Mohamed, yes. Mohamed, please. Go ahead, Mohamed.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Olivia, for the question. Yes, the CSC has been, as a liaison for at large, or an ALAC in this CSC, there has been a lot of discussion about the need for a dedicated website for PTI, and that's something that the PTI is now working on. The first report has been circulated in the mailing list. It should be online. But there's lots of work needs to be done in terms of how to disseminate and put information online. I think it's about, because PTI is almost 1 month or 1 month and a half now in terms of the public operation. So, yeah, but I agree with you, there's lots of work needs to be done on how to communicate the message in a simple way. Thank you.
Thank you, Mohamed. Alberto Soto.
This is Alberto Soto for the record. Thank you very much, Tishani. I asked my question in the chat, but I think it got lost. My question is simple. What is the amount of people, how many people does the PTI have right now to fulfill all its functions? Thank you.
Thank you, Alberto.
I cannot give an exact number because they're looking into hiring more people, but it's around 18 to 20 people.
Hi, this is Isham speaking. I just have a heads up from our operator that I think Tijani has dropped.
Yep.
So we'll be trying to reach out to him as soon as possible. Currently redialing him.
Yashim, it's Olivier. May I, in the meantime, ask a question, please, if there is no
other person
in the queue? Thanks very much for this, Olivier Catanablanc. on the transcript quickly. The nature of the employment of those PTI employees, are they still employed by ICANN now, or has it been has this question been resolved, or are they contracted over to PTI?
It's Lise was speaking again. They are for the moment on an ICANN contract, but they're planned to be transferred within 2 years, so everyone should be transferred within the next 2 years in order to ensure that all the benefits, so they have the same working conditions. But it is for sure that everyone will be transferred within 2 years, and it's not. Like in the beginning, there was some a request for having only newly hired people on a PTI contract, but that's been dropped. It's going to be everyone, but within 2 years. Thank you.
This is Ishan again. We are still trying to reach out to Tijani. Don't have him on the phone bridge yet. So anyone else who would like to ask a question? Actually, I have my hand raised because there's a question on the AC chat from Abdul Jalil Bashar Bong. He's asking, how can I explain quickly to an end user who don't know about IANA transition and PTI? Mohamed or Lisa, if you would like to answer the question, please.
Thank you. If I can start by answering that, and maybe Lisa could follow up if she wants. I think it's in a simple term, for the internet services we know to function, it needs critical unique internet identifiers, IP addresses for users, and IP addresses to identify servers or providing services to end users, which is basically the numbers, which is we don't like as humans to write. That's why we use domain names, which is also is an important system for us as end users. To use the internet in a simple, friendly way and get information. And protocol parameters as well are important technical standards. So IANA ensures that this information is provided in a central repository and that we have one resource for those important critical resources which is for running the internet. So I think in a simple terms, for the internet to function for us as end users, IANA play a critical role in that. And sometimes, and I think majority of the times, we don't feel about that, we don't know it, because it's working fine. There's lots of dedicated people who are doing that work in the PTI currently.
Thank you, Mohamed. Thank you.
Your answers.
Thank you very much, Yashin.
Yes, Tijani.
This question is very important for us.
Yep.
Okay, go ahead. Go ahead, Yashin.
Oh, sure, thank you. I just wanted to say that I'm going to keep the AC room like this, showing the left question. So anyone who would like to give any response, they can keep on writing their answers till the end of this webinar. So over to you, Tijani. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Shin. So as I said, this question is very important for us as working group, so that we know what are the topics that you wish us to program for the next year. So please continue to put your priorities, and if you don't have time now, you can send an email to our staff to tell them what are the topics that you wish us to program for our next program, for the program of next year. Okay, so now we still have time, and you still have two distinguished speakers. Please ask questions. Please tell them what you want them to tell you. It is a unique opportunity for you. We still have 13 minutes. But if you don't have any question, any interrogation, any remark, I will close this webinar thanking first our two speakers, Lise and Mohamed. Thank you very, very much. Also, I would like to thank our staff, wonderful staff, and our interpreters. And thank you all for attending this webinar. I hope you understood better what is PTI and what does it do, et cetera, et cetera. All the CSC, the ISR, et cetera. Thank you very much, and this webinar is now adjourned.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Bye.
This webinar is now adjourned. The audio will now be disconnected. Have a lovely rest of the day and happy holidays. And a happy new year. Thank you all. Bye-bye.
Everyone, happy holidays. Bye-bye.